So just a few days ago, an update was made to ComfyUI announcing support for the ByteDance USO model, which stands for Unified Style Subject Optimized. Basically, you could think of it as a fancy new IP adapter that supports Flux models. Now, this supports both subject-driven as well as style-driven generations, or in fact, a combination of the two. However, though, after some testing for just a bit, I am noticing some glaring faults with the model, but there are also really good strengths. You can kind of think of it, like I said, as an IP adapter or even like a Flux context. So let's go ahead and take a look at the workflow that is provided by ComfyUI. I'll put a link to that in the description, as well as a modified version that I'm going to be using in this video over on the Prompting Pixels website. First up, let's take a look at the subject-driven generation capabilities of this new model. I have here Flux Dev FP8 loaded along with all the required models. And again, there will be a link to this post within the description from ComfyUI so you can know where to place these on your own machine. But with this photo here, I have is of a man. And the prompt here is I have a photo of a smiling man sitting in a coffee shop wearing a suit. Let's give it a shot here. So basically, what I'm looking for before this is done generating is the same person in the same likeness wearing a suit placed in a coffee shop instead of sitting outside. So we can see it's good, but really not great. I think, you know, something like Flux Context might be a little bit better at this kind of task, but we can see the likeness is similar, but definitely not the same. At a lower weight of 1, we see a lot of quality loss, particularly in this image in the face area. But he is wearing the same sort of undershirt as well as jacket. Some of the details remained, such as like the buttons, but the zipper was lost. And of course, he's in a coffee shop, but not wearing a suit. I would give this maybe, you know, a few years ago, I would have said this was an A. But, you know, given all the recent developments of models, maybe this is more like a C or so in this task. But if you lower this lower weight down to, say, around 0.5, you can kind of steer the model to make a little bit better of results, but not great. So we'll see here in just a second. Now we have the man. He looks really nothing alike. So the style preservation was kind of lost, but has a lot of the same features, if you will, such as like a beard, same sort of hairstyle generally. And he is wearing a suit now, two buttons going on there. So some of the details are lost or did carry over, but you know, for our task is we wanted him wearing a suit. Really notable, depending on what your use case is I'm noticing that it does do a really good job with clothing or articles, if you will. So that same undershirt is being carried over just kind of in a new context here. However, though, I find that around 0.75 or so on the lower weight is really the sweet spot. Again, you'll want to test this yourself depending on whatever your use case is. We're seeing a lot of the same features, but I said for a suit, and so it's not a suit, but it did do a good job of carrying this over and kind of carrying over a better quality, same sort of likeness of the subject here. So that's with this kind of test case. So again, it's not the strongest model out there for subject-driven generations, but it's okay. Here's where I kind of was wondering where it really goes wrong is I'm going to change this over to a woman sitting in a garden wearing a red dress. All right, so let's generate this. So here's our input and our output. Two completely different women here, two different ethnicities, not even close on subject preservation here. You could argue that maybe some of the details like the hairstyle is carrying over well, and of course this shoulder strap from the purse, but everything else is just kind of lost. I mean, it's not at all subject preservation. Now, if we crank this up to 1, it does do a little bit better. Even in my testing, I was finding that. Of course, you know, we're working with, actually we are with a fixed seed. We'll see if this is the same. I think I changed the prompt a little bit, but let's take a look. Again, it's really no likeness whatsoever, even at the strongest strength of the LoRa. So with that, I would give that just pretty much a fail on it. Now, let's turn this back down to around, we're going to try with 0.6. And I'm going to use the same woman. And we're going to bring in a style blend to the image. And this is where things really get interesting with this model. Here's an image, give you an idea of what it looks like. It's definitely more of an illustrative image. And let's generate this. So what I'm expecting here is kind of like a blend between these two, these sorts of colors. And this is definitely, there's some disfigurement going on here, but very interesting as far as the style. It really captures it a lot better. Those blues are really coming through, which is quite neat. Let me change this over to a man and generate that. Now, there are just a couple of notes in general, especially for this, for subject driven generations. You could definitely steer the model more definitively with less broad terms. It's definitely something I'm kind of doing a disservice on. You could definitely be very specific on what it is that you want that person to have in order to try to push it in the direction you're hoping for. So here we go. We can see a very nice illustrative example. Really not much for subject preservation, but I do like the output. So, depending on your use case, there could definitely be some applications here. So that's a blend of both subject and style-driven generations. Now let's just go over to style-driven generations. So I'm going to go down. Again, this workflow, a link to it is in the description. So here was the first one that I tested earlier, and I thought this was really fascinating. And what's really interesting to me is I have a photo of the Mona Lisa as kind of driving the style of this image. And I'm noticing every time I tried the generations is it was actually putting men in time period outfits. It wasn't a modern outfit, which suggests to me, at least my understanding of it, is that with perhaps the Clip Vision model, and how those embeddings work behind the scenes whenever you generate an image, it understands the time period of the Mona Lisa and it generates styles according to that. So I thought that was interesting. Now, I'm doing this on a random seed and watch, it's not going to work again, but I did like 5 generations and they were all men in these sort of time period outfits, which again, is really interesting. And it's also too, I guess, perhaps, on how it's looking at the Mona Lisa and understanding that image and putting that into the embedded space or latent space through the use of embeddings and in generating these sorts of outputs. Definitely a neat application to this. And of course, we can see the style. It's not like the exact style of Da Vinci, but it's pretty close. Now, here's where things can get a little fun is blending styles. So what happens if we blend the Mona Lisa with this illustrative content, kind of get a blend of both of those together, which we can see is the case. And this is really, really neat. You can do this for anything, of course, just like you would with an IP adapter or style transfer. So let's just say a dog in the streets of New York City. And again, we'll go ahead and make that generation. Now, as that's going, I'm going to kind of blend together a couple of illustrations to kind of see some other applications for this. So again, our output looks absolutely beautiful for like a rough sketch for, say a children's book or something to that effect. So let's go to illustration 1 and illustration 2, just to give you an idea of what this one looks like. This is kind of more of like a flat style that's of illustration. And we got kind of a red and blue blends. And we're kind of seeing that over into our final piece here. So some really neat outputs that you can generate with the combination of the two styles. Again, that's a look at the brand new ByteDance USO model. Again, it stands for Unified Style Subject Optimized. I hope that you found this video helpful. Again, a link to all the resources used in this video are available in the description. And of course, if you have any questions, drop it in the comment section below. Thanks so much for watching, guys, and I'll see you in the next one. Take care.